pheromone?
My name is Fracture.
Birth certificate. Seriously, it's Fracture. We're going to show you guys some really cool tips on how to do cosplay, not necessarily in kind of like the over-gratuitous fiberglass way that you might have heard before, but we're going to, basically, it's better on the budget if you use kind of like lighter weight materials, but it's also better on storage. I always like to start off with like an example of how you can take a what would typically be an expensive costume and make it cheaper. Fiberglass armor is great. I mean, it looks amazing, it feels amazing, it's weighted, it's fantastic, but it isn't always going to pass con standards for one if for some reason you've got something big and bulky with like spikes sticking off of it. And the other thing is if it breaks, it's very expensive to rebuild, and you can't exactly rebuild it at the convention. What I've actually got up here, and I'll bring this down to pass it around, it's a little glued up because I had to take some stuff off of it, but it was the body plate I did for the Emperor from Final Fantasy II. And as you can see, just to kind of get a feel for your first experience with vacuform, it's bendable, it's fine, it's kind of frisbee-like, and the way that we have it kind of like strapped in, it wears just like any other costume would, but without having to worry about, oh, if this breaks, I'll never be able to build it again, I'll never be able to redo it. So I'm going to pass this around that way.
The other thing that's actually going to be great about the what we're using is actually not only the fact that it's inexpensive, but also it's very lightweight compared like to your normal chain gun that you see a lot of people re-wearing. And it's also, it has a lot of breathability compared to some people that wear cardboard as their armor pieces. Now, so the cardboard actually is not, you know, a great way to go ahead and construct your armor. However, because of the fact that actually you're allowed to go ahead and have air move freely through it, cardboard is not very porous. Plastic isn't either, but however, you can actually go ahead and make it to where you can make it breathable for you. This way you're not going to be overheating, you're not going to experience a lot of problems, such as when you need like some big costumes.
And we usually start with armor, we're not just here, so those of you who are like, oh, I want to make things with lights on them, or oh, I want to make really cool wigs, we will cover that, but I like to start with armor because I think it's kind of like the cosplay boogeyman, besides like wings, it's the thing that like everyone...
ABS.
Yeah, it's, oh, yes. To start with, I probably should have mentioned that, the plastic is extremely cheap. It's sold by the, I guess, square yard, and it's all of maybe $1 a square yard. So I spent maybe $20 worth of plastic in 2009, and I still haven't used all of it. So it's one of the great things is once you get the vacuum set up, and we'll talk about how the box is built, it's probably like the most cosplay cost effective than anything. Because if you're doing things like, you worked with, what are those mats?
Oh yes, the when you go into weight rooms and everything, you have the EVA foam, which is actually what they put all the workout equipment on to keep it from slipping when you're actually using it. It was very, very nice to use because like the ABS and the 0.4 plastic, it's very, very bendable and you can go ahead and secure it with duct tape and it actually doesn't move. The problem with it is that for a stack of 5 mats, it's $20. And so for what I used it for, I used it for Surfbot from Marvel's Capcom 2. The problem I ran into is that if I messed up a cut, it was a big issue. And on top of that, the other thing that came into play is I kept having to buy more and more. It wasn't just, I can go ahead and say, this is it, I'm done. The problem with, I had to go ahead and go to Walmart, I had to go to Target, I basically literally went and bought the ones even they use for kids, ABCD, because I was just so desperate to go ahead and get it finished, and I didn't want to spend $20 more, so it ended up being what turned into usually about $80 to $100 costume, turned into about $262.
Yeah, and I mean, it can happen, costumes can get expensive, and some of them you are going to have to make the investment, but if you don't have to, you don't necessarily like need to go ahead and go the ABA foam route. The other thing that I think is really great about the vacuform method, which we'll show you today, is that not only can you replace pieces that are broken, and you're not particularly worried like what's going to happen to the piece while you're wearing it, if you've got like a Power Ranger group, or like, I don't know, Insectors or Big Bad Beetleborgs or something like that, everybody's got similar pieces and you can just keep crafting the same piece over and over. We're going to make a few objects today just to kind of get you started, but it does everything from like two-sided weapon blades to jewelry to, I have to make a new one of these today, but Link's little bracer thing from Legend of Zelda. And this one actually, it was craft foam and it is kind of like 3 or 4 years old, so it's kind of starting to fall apart. You can kind of replicate your old pieces that you already have existing without having to like start from scratch, and everything's seamless. That's the other thing. If you do, If you do craft foam and you're stacking craft foam pieces on top of each other, the reason why it's so susceptible to breaking is because you have multiple pieces of craft foam stacked on one another. The hot glue bonds can break. When you put wear and tear by physically moving it, they can crack over here. So it's with this, you just have one full piece, and it doesn't really do or go anywhere, so.
Yeah.
I'm not particularly sure they do. Most of the places you would buy ABS styrene are just plumbing supply units. They do sell really big sheets because this stuff is supposed to be like plumbing insulation, and that's why it's so cheap. It wouldn't be cost effective to build a building out of something that was $20 a square foot. So you can also get it. The stormtroopers use this for their armor. They use a slightly thicker version. ABS styrene is measured in percents of an inch, and so 4% of an inch, 0.040, is the stormtrooper grade armor. You wouldn't think it's that much.
It's over. No.
They recognized you.
I was late.
Okay.
There was a BBC show about Cosplay outside of
the store. Oh, okay. Completely legitimate. Everybody, this is Clover.
Hi, guys.
We were just covering plastic.
Oh, plastics.
We were going over like the stormtrooper stuff is like 0.040, and you saw that stuff. You can stomp on the 0.040 if you need like really thick armor. It doesn't absorb the details.
It's ridiculously cheap too to get. Yeah. That's big thing about it. Like
actually,
you can have sheets and sheets.
What
and
I
sheets
used the 0.040 for was when we went to Red Fence. We actually dressed up as people from Stargate, so we actually made our own Stargate transponder out of 0.040. Because the fact that we actually wanted to be able to go ahead and toss it around during our skit. When we walk through the Red Quest area.
Yeah, just like...
And 0.04 is mainly used. Stormtroopers actually use 0.04. That's all they use because of the fact that it's so durable.
It's so durable, yeah.
It's so durable.
The only limit is your imagination, too, because like we've gotten bored in vacuum-formed pairs of scissors.
Which we'll do today.
Yes, it'll be fun.
And actually, we got bored, I think, at a fence last year, and we decided when I was dressed up as Timmy Turner, we vacuum-formed a baby. And when I say baby, I'm talking about...
Not a real baby.
Not a real baby. Not a real baby.
My fence is not liable for any damaged children.
But no, when we do a vacuum form, actually, we found out that actually the styrofoam holds up to vacuum form.
Really?
Yeah,
you kind of have to like experiment. I built this box in 2009, and every now and again, I will just kind of get bored and just like, man, what can I melt today?
We're like mad scientists. You're just like, okay, what do I want to kind of make an impression of? Because you're like... Oh, so many cool things I can go ahead and make.
Or it's great for groups too if you have multiple pieces of armor or multiple, like everybody has to have the same bracer or everybody has to do that because you can just copy paste.
One of the things I think I haven't mentioned is no gloves, no need for ventilation, I don't use any goggles or anything. You can touch it almost instantaneously. I'll probably grab something.
It's
like
one of the very few things that you can make armor out of that you don't need to be like outside in the middle of the field
to
not have brain damage. So
you really don't have to sand it either.
Yeah, you don't have to sand or anything before you paint. And one of the great things is this unit, it's kind of like a portable one. People do a little bit more elaborate setups using their oven and whatnot.
Those are the ones that, like, it's why we think that today, like,
the
Stormtrooper is so unobtainable because it's so expensive to make, like, the big oven thing.
Yeah, but
it's not realistic to carry around either.
You can bring this actually to a convention. I mean, we did. You can have this in your hotel room as long as nobody minds the noise of vacuum.
And don't worry, we'll show you how it works.
Oh, yeah, it probably takes all of 2 seconds, but I guess we're building up the hype so you don't leave.
Yeah.
Exactly. We'll just die.
Does anybody have any questions?
Yes, we could do a demo. Are you guys, do you want to see the vacuum form table? We're here for the goods, right?
I know. Let me grab some
scissors. And one of the other things is also really good thing too.
I haven't talked about the construction of the box. Okay. I guess that would be a good time. The box, let me lift it up real fast, is basically just a...
And you guys can't come up with
come up
closer and see it.
The box is, I used, you know that stuff in the back of your father's garage that has little holes in it? It's listed
pegboard.
Up there. Okay, yeah,
pegboard.
It's the pegboard from the front, and basically that gives you the holes, and they're all evenly spaced.
This is so empty. You know why you guys are up here. We're not...
Yeah, you could drill it, but there's really no reason to if you can just use pegboard.
It's just forming a box.
Yeah,
like, you can do it any shape, any size if you want it longer.
See, honestly, I mean, it's just wood. I'm not even that good of a carpenter.
Oh, and just to seal the cracks, just tape.
It's aluminum tape to seal the cracks. The attachment you see is honestly just the attachment.
Is this a vacuum cleaner? Yes.
Yeah, it's a vacuum cleaner attachment. That's honestly how it hooks up. There's, I think we might have caulked the first one we built. The reason why there's contact paper on, you'll see in a second, when you have smaller objects, in order to have the airflow come out right, you have to limit the space that it's sucking through. So at one point, I only needed this much, and I drilled holes through.
Yeah,
grab. I have scissors. There's paper right here. So I guess we'll make a copy of
guys, like seriously, you save so much money on armor and sitting there trying to finagle it each time.
And I'm going to demonstrate how the vacuum seal works real fast. I usually just use like old homework.
Scissors? Not
do
homework.
Where are they at? Not do homework. You see how the box kind of like folds a little in on itself. The reason it folds in is because it's, the wood is malleable and it's the force of the suction is sucking that down. So we're going to do, just put something like, that works.
And you have to do it beautiful because you're going to have to...
We might need a little smaller than that, but...
Make it work.
Okay. Grab me...
What do you want to do? Okay, scissors.
Yeah.
And then we want to do a link
bracer.
Yeah, let's do a link bracer. Link bracer. I'm going to make a link bracer.
Okay. And this is also good if all
this is so low tech too, and that's the thing, is it's been this big secret forever, like how can I possibly make plastic armor?
I'm gonna need to make this piece about that big. Okay. And you see, no gloves, no goggles, we're really just kind of haphazardly doing this.
Which be careful with the heat gun on your hand and all that stuff.
The heat gun is a paint melting gun that goes up to 500 degrees Fahrenheit. So it is very hot, but as long as you're not pointing it at yourself and just at the plastic, you're gonna be fine.
So when you're doing larger pieces, like a chess piece, you still use the heat gun because you can't heat the whole area.
You still use the heat gun. You'll see when I'm doing this. You kind of trace
it. It's like waves. It's kind of like doing nail polish.
The other
like
part will stay hot enough while you heat another.
Well, it doesn't have to all be hot at once. Essentially, you heat up this part. You see that there's suction building, and you follow the trace line of the suction until it's completely done.
Whenever you see it,
it looks like magic.
You heat it while you're sucking. Usually you heat the piece up and then.
Yeah. There's another method that does that where you heat it up in the oven, but not every oven heats up evenly. Unless you have a convection oven made for like baking cakes or whatever, you're going to have plastic that's saggy in the center but really rigid at the edges.
Well,
so we try to drop
everybody has different heats on their oven. Now, mind you, will probably ruin a few pieces. Like,
yeah,
something
but
that
the plastic's only $1 a foot, so, or excuse me, $1 a square yard.
A square yard. Exactly.
Also, consider food safety if you're going to heat it in an oven.
Too. You don't want the plastic fumes going straight up. Okay.
You get plastic cake.
I think that's big enough. I think we can go ahead and hit the
button. Yeah. I think you guys hit enough real time.
You can see the outline. The outline will start to form immediately just from the suction. That's how you know you're doing it right. And then after that, you really just get your heat gun, start going over a piece of it, and just fold your way up. So that's what I'm going to be doing. So.
Go for it.
Okay. Go.
Okay.
I thought I'd kill it early. The more detail you want, the more you're gonna have to just kind of
work at it.
You sit there
and love on
it. Yeah.
As you can see,
I cut this one a little early. Is it cool already? Like, can we go ahead and? Yeah.
Yep.
See, that's fine.
A little bit of burning foam wakes you right up.
When you get a staunch for this, you don't get the like, no wrinkling, or you get the little like. How do they?
Yeah. With those, they use the thicker one. The thicker one doesn't wrinkle as much because it doesn't want to change shape as much.
And
the
usually they'll do it in parts too, where it's like on a dome to get that perfect dome, and put it like on a metal bowl or something. Too.
Yeah, yeah, so with stormtrooper armor, they actually go ahead and take the actual stormtrooper armor in actually two separate pieces. They do the back half or the front half first, and then they also, I've seen them actually do one half on the going actually horizontally. So this half of the mask is how they actually just kind of seam it through with hot glue.
Yeah. I think with the stormtroopers, they also use like giant wood blocks. They all carve it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so that's a little like.
It's pretty hard. It's
pretty crazy.
They do a lot of casting.
Yeah.
And
they do plaster work.
I never see I always see the wrinkling on the arm when you do those thicker depth pieces. And that's why I'm like, I don't want to start this because of it.
Well, and that's the problem is that most of us aren't going to be making stormtrooper armor in reality, or we just don't need that thick, hard grade armor. So.
And it also depends, like, for the stormtrooper, they actually use different types of armor too, because depending on if you're doing a sand trooper or you're doing a regular stormtrooper, the sand trooper is going to use an even thicker version of this.
Oh, yeah.
And that one requires 500 degrees Fahrenheit just to melt it. And it's a constant study.
I don't think
we have the motorcycle casing stuff.
People use it for making like light sheets and bolt holsters and stuff like that. It is plastic and you form it with a heat gun.
That's what I thought.
It doesn't stretch.
But I've never looked at it's extremely durable. But I've never looked at vacuum forming it. But
this is the more flimsy stuff. Of course. You can't get with the motorcycle casing stuff. I forget what you call it.
Kydex. I'm gonna do a pair of.
That actually, I've seen a lot of people work with it, but it's the same concept. You could still probably get shoes out of this way too. Actually, you could probably use that on here.
I'm gonna do a pair of scissors real fast. One part because it's my favorite, but also it'll show you what deeper objects will start to look like when you get like daggers, swords, etc. Sometimes if an object's kind of flat, you might see that it takes a while to get the details smoothed in. That's why when I kill the heat on those link bracers.
Like you could actually get that link bracer a lot more detailed.
Yeah, it just takes time. You gotta have a little bit of patience. So. Swimming in plastic. Okay. Yeah, this is big enough.
Is that a static heat gun you're using, or a dynamic temperature control?
I think it's temperature control.
Yeah, it's temperature control. It has 0, 1, 2 settings, so it has three separate settings.
Just 300 and 500.
It's mainly a heat gun used to go ahead and melt the paint.
So what are you using? What are you using for this?
The setting I'm using is 500 degrees, and it wasn't Fahrenheit. I misspoke. It's actually 500 Celsius, which is way hotter.
Yeah.
Way hotter.
Yeah. Okay, just check it.
Yes, my bad. Okay. Go ahead and make sure they're right.
Yes.
Plastic and synthetic, and based on you can pretty much put whatever you like over top of
suitable for larger pieces.
Oh, you can make these much larger. Hockey pad. This was actually just a hockey like fabric thing you get from Walmart.
Yeah, this one again. What happens when you rush is if you burn a hole through the plastic, the suction is like completely gone because it's all coming out from there. So this is a not so great piece.
Still, but you're gonna ruin pieces.
It happens.
Patch it with a little square of plastic.
Well, exactly. You could actually.
So cheap.
No, it is. It's the thing. It's extreme.
Yeah, it happened because it got too hot, and what happened is the plastic becomes too weak, and it sucks a hole straight through. And then the other thing that happened was I let an air bubble come out the side. So that's what's going to happen.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Enjoy the information.
Trying to think. If not scissors, then what?
Stop vacuum.
Okay, fine. I get the idea.
It's an addiction.
It is a lot of fun to be able to make a lot of cast of stuff. I've done Super Nintendo controllers just for like little Captain N, or I guess it'd be a Nintendo controller. I've done big giant T on a Taskmaster shield.
It's also great for little things, like if you have the Sailor Moon like hair bracelets
I did that jewelry from, I did a couple of jewelry pieces where I just needed this same thing for my dagger, and I just went over and over and over and had it like here, etc. And it paints really easy. You can use Kryolan spray paint, which is a paint meant for going around plastic, but you can also use just, this was like airbrush paint meant for models, and that was like a buck. You can use nail polish, because that's meant for going on a lot of hard surfaces.
It's true.
Yeah, like and this is actually just a smaller version. The one actually that I constructed is actually a 3x5.
Yeah, yours is fancy.
And mine has a little handle for it, and actually the one I use it for is actually, I use it to replicate keyblades.
Yeah.
So I replicate one half, and I go ahead and flip it over, and I actually go ahead and do the other half, and I still use hot glue, and just glue the seams out, sand them out, buff it, paint it like I'm supposed to, and go ahead and take some rub and buff, and it makes it all nice and shiny.
Rub and buff makes it everything better.
What's great about this plastic, specifically with the hot glue gun, plastic usually doesn't have any porous surfaces for glue to stick to, but this just fuses, it melts.
Yeah.
So when you're hot gluing it, it just becomes part of the plastic.
And the heat gun in general, let me say that it's not just buying it for this. You're going to end up, you can use that on many other things in cosplay, like helping with wigs and doing covers and all that stuff.
Well, if you want to retile your kitchen.
That too.
Well, we said at the beginning we weren't going to just cover the vacuum stuff since there's other things like lighting, etc. But if there's any questions.
Does anybody have anything that they're trying to make or something that's stumping them or general ideas? We could talk about wigs. Anybody want to talk about wigs? How to color wigs? You curious?
Yes.
We have one. With wigs, one of the big things is that everybody wants to be able to have their own custom colors. I have a really, really, really easy trick. And let's say that I want to make this white wig into a blue wig. All you need, and once again, we go for everything being very cheap. All you need to do is go to Walmart and you get an empty, actually you don't even need to, if you have an empty Windex bottle or any type of spray bottle laying around, you can go and you get about, I would say, 5 markers minimum, maybe 8 to be safe. You get permanent markers. Like, I go and get blue permanent markers just in the stick. What you need to do is get, like, a pair of scissors or pliers or whatever you need to do to cut the tip off of the permanent marker. And what you do is there's a little felt tube on the inside, and you pull it out, and it's just filled with dye. You put that into your spray bottle. You put all 5 of them in there. You can cut them open if you want the felt to really get out there, but get the highest concentration of alcohol, purest.
They have like 90%.
They have 90% at Fry's now, and I know that at Kroger's and stuff, they have 80% alcohol. You just take that bottle, fill it up with alcohol, and you let that set for about an hour. You just shake it up, and it becomes this blue solution of just dye. And whenever you spray it on the wig fiber, the problem is you can't use dyes on wig because they don't absorb anything. They're just plastic. You have to imagine that they're just pieces of plastic stretched out. That's what they are. And all you do with this spray bottle, spray it on, the alcohol evaporates, and voila. Mm-hmm. And you can also go back and do like spot touching with it and all that with permanent marker. that's just going to be your safest bet.
Yeah, the permanent marker does work on the wigs normally. So if you get like those J-Rocker haircuts where you get like the black bangs and the red tips, you can actually take a red wig and just black permanent marker and just go in and color every strand. I did an entire blonde wig green, and it took way too many markers, but you honestly can't just hand color.
I helped him with half of that, and I'm still kind of stupid.
Yeah.
I think it was in between every class you went to your car, right?
Yeah, it was between classes. I would go back to my car.
Oh, that's
like, color. I'm not going to climb my car, guys. I'm just coloring.
I'm on the markers.
If you actually do go ahead and do the solution dye, I do recommend go ahead and not doing it in your bathtub.
Oh, yes. That's one thing is that, like, I dyed a Reno wig at one point. I still have, like, parts of my cabinets that are red. I'm like...
The other thing is to make sure you wear gloves because, I mean, sharpie markers, you know, they're supposed to be permanent. And they will come off and everything, but you don't want to go ahead and be going into your profession and coming in there with blue hands or red hands.
I did something bad, I hope.
It's important to note that it is marker chemicals, so if your wig does rub up against, like, the inside of a collar of a white shirt, it might actually...
Yeah, you might get a little bit of flaking here. Does happen. If you really want to make sure it's out of there, just give it a nice good cold bath.
Yeah, you just rinse the wigs.
Like, it's very, very nice.
And while we're talking about wigs with water, another trick about if you need to make a curly wig straight, all you do is put it on your wig head, which you can get from Sally's for very cheap, and you basically just give it a shower, and you hold it underneath a hot shower. And again, whenever a wig comes out of the factory, whatever form it is set in, whenever it comes out of the factory after it cools, is what it permanently is. It's just plastic fiber. So if you imagine whenever hot water is just pouring over it repeatedly, it relaxes those fibers, and once they reset, it becomes straight.
Yeah, it's really cool actually, because it's almost like taking plastic and when it heats up, it's kind of
strange. Get out of our panel room.
We're kidding,
that's one of our friends. We're just cruel people, sorry. You're lucky you were already here. But no, another thing too, a lot of people have to ask about flat ironing wigs. Really, you need to be careful if you're going to attempt to flat iron a wig, because once again, it's plastic and not real hair. Our real hair is made to withstand like
anything.
Exactly, it's real, it's part of us. But if you, maybe if you have an extremely, extremely, like none of your typical cheese are gonna, they're gonna be way too hot even on the lowest setting. If you have an old crappy one and you put it on setting one, sometimes you actually can sit there and get little things out of it. Just be careful though and test the strand first or else you're gonna be so sad. Because the minute that hot irons touch wigs, it just goes and curls up like terrible and it smells. But, and now mind you, if you have a human hair wig, they're much more expensive to tell you, but they can actually handle
anything.
They can be dyed.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, actually, what I've actually been experimenting with is actually making human hair wigs because I really don't like polymer wigs. I hate eating plastic. So actually, when I did Mr. 3 for Enemy Overload, his whole wig actually was made out of human hair. And I went to Sally's and I was able to go ahead and get $20. I was able to go ahead and get me a wig cap and the wig rips. And then from there, all you do is go ahead and take a D. You can go to like any type of a fabric store and ask for a D suture or a D needle. And it looks like just like this, half of a D. And you go ahead and just take any type of string, you know, that's matching to your hair color. Just go ahead and start weaving it. And you can just sew it onto the wig cap, onto your wig head.
Yeah, the way wigs work is there's a series of wefts, and it's essentially a whole bunch of wig hair or human hair glued onto either a piece of paper or sewn into a piece of fabric, and so it just strips kind of like
everything
that.
Is in lines in a wig.
Yeah, and you can see like the wig netting right here if you look real closely.
And see, whenever you make wefts, all you're doing is making like a strip of hair that goes this way and hangs down. There's many ways to do very quick wefts too if you're interested in it. You can do a sewing manner. I've seen people do it through tape. I've seen people do it through hot glue even.
Yeah.
We had a friend who made an entire wig out of fishing line. That's right.
Amazing.
Well, you make that face because that's what we all
do. She's not completely crazy.
She is.
when you need a wig that's 6 feet long, it's typically very expensive or very difficult to find. So her idea was just to have a 6 foot long bass fishing line and just kind of weave these same wefts that she went up the wig. Thank goodness it actually saved her life when she fell off stage.
Oh God, it was so funny. She fell off stage and she actually got caught and was suspended just by the wig.
Yeah, because the wig any one of those strands was supposed to hold up, I guess, what, a 40-pound bass?
Yes.
So an army of those strands was holding up.
Like a large man could swing off her wig. Actually, no, the thing is, whenever you, if you're looking for a super long wig, it's always going to, like, the Godiva wigs are usually a long wig. And it is this really ratted, it tangles usually. Like, if you're going to get a really long wig, make sure, I always say you get what you pay for with wigs. Because you really, if you want it to be grande, fabulous, you're going to have to spend at least $40. But, let me say, with the magic of eBay, you really can find some.
Oh yeah, China wants to sell you wigs for a dollar. Like, I don't know why.
I don't know why. I've got $1 China wigs, and they're actually kind of nice.
Is that what? How much Chinese is it?
It is a dollar.
It is a Chinese. It's dollar.
Like $4.
Yeah. One of the things about the human hair wigs, before we leave the subject of wigs, is they are human hair, and I have this Yu-Gi-Oh! Costume that I did out of human hair, and every time I put the costume on, I basically have to restyle the hair. It's like if you had like a permanent haircut, it's perfect, but you put it on, like, redo the hairspray, okay? Because it's natural hair, and the blood, sweat, and toil that you're putting into these conventions is going to make the hair fall, kind of start to fall flat.
I can actually also tell them about stuff wrong things.
Yeah.
And if you guys are curious how to make your typical, like, bouncy anime bangs that you see,
Era
like the gorgeous Era Sephiroth of all the Final Fantasy characters, this is really easy. All you do is get whatever wig you're going to use, you part away the front pieces, like so. You pin the thing to a wig head, you flip it upside down, and just hang it. And you spray right here, and if you want, you can get two toilet paper rolls and just put it right there underneath. But you just sit there and let it hang upside down, and you can blow dry it and spray hairspray. And it's so easy, it sticks up. And you can, once you actually have it upside down, you start to get a feel for it. But it's just hanging it and making them balance. And you can actually get that permanent, like,
it might sound crazy, but it's just science. Essentially, the hairspray is glue, and the plastic is just normally bonding with it anyway. So all you're doing is making like a fishnet, like spray permanent nest of hair.
That's the thing. You kind of have to convince the wig slowly. It's like a person, like leading horse to water. Like, come on, be a man, just do it.
I like interrogation.
Yeah, exactly. Are you a little bit rougher?
Yes, I'm a little bit rougher.
But.
Yeah.
Also, don't be afraid, like, if, he had a wig at one point that had a big snake that came out of it and had horns on it. All you do is put the base, like, if you can imagine making a cone, has a wide, flat base, and it has, like, the pyramid coming out, you put it through the bottom of the wig, and it catches on that lip, and that's how you can put horns through it, and it's perfectly fine. When you find a web. Yeah, exactly.
You've got too wide of the base, and you just get it through the netting, so it just stays there.
And that's really simple. You actually, the act of your head being pushed on that flat base will just hold it
yeah,
off.
Yeah, it just basically, like, I guess if I could pull this down, it should basically just be like that, to where it just, and you'll get times where this will happen, and you'll be like, okay, I have to straighten my hair, but that's any costume, you have to come
exactly.
Straighten yourself.
Just don't be afraid to rip that wig apart.
Yeah, and the other thing is, too, with a lot of anime, especially video game characters, they always seem to have the gravity-defying hair.
Oh, yeah.
I swear to God, they all just sit around in a room, and they're like, how can we mess with the cosplayer?
Exactly.
The new Final Fantasy, let's make it have a floating barbecue pit in the hair.
Let's give it a halo that actually doesn't attach to their head, but just kind of just hangs there on the side. But it doesn't touch any hair whatsoever. Yeah, actually, gravity defying is actually not that difficult. You just got to work with it. The one thing that I did for Jimmy Neutron was he has the, oh, look, I'm looking at the ice cream cone. Yeah. So what I did is actually, when I actually took the wig, I cut it down the size I wanted it, and then I realized I cut it too small.
Which does happen.
Which does happen. So I saved some of the pieces and just kind of like glued back on. But what I did is actually in the middle, so it means right in the middle, I took a cup and just fixated it right here.
Is that what that
was? Yeah, it was just a paper cup.
That's amazing.
And all I did is actually I just took hot glue because it's plastic. I just kind of started pulling it this way.
One man's leftover Burger King is another man's.
Exactly. I had a Burger King pizza go back.
It is important though. You can't weigh it down too much. Using a paper cup is a great idea because you can't use, because it's plastic, you can't use styling gel. That's just going to make your wig kind of like shiny and wet. You can't use hair dye. You can't use any punk rock methods, so don't use like egg whites.
Oh, that's
or
one thing.
Kool-Aid. Like, do not use Kool-Aid.
It will rot. It will rot in the wig and it will make it a mess. So, yeah. Oh, by the way, you can bathe your wigs. It's called just shampoo,
yeah,
water, and use it cool water, or else we're going to go into that stretching thing.
And don't use caulking.
No,
caulking is very toxic.
Oh, I've heard about that.
I've heard several people go ahead and doing age-defying and the gravity wigs with caulking. It's a very, very nifty thing. The problem is, though, is that there's actually a warning label that says, if you make in contact with your actual skin, it will be absorbed and cause you to do bad things.
So you're poisoning yourself.
Exactly.
Awesome. So you have to realize you sweat.
You sweat, and your pores expand. And when your pores expand, that means you take in more stuff than they're supposed to.
Therefore,
more toxin than you say they're supposed to. So they always say that when you dye your hair so much, you actually cause yourself brain damage. Well, you're doing that just by using caulking in your
hair.
Wait, really?
Yeah. You might want to watch out for that.
God, I'm going to have like one poor brain cell left.
So yeah, for the gravity fine guys, you're going to just need something to go ahead and just kind of mount it on. For the new Jimmytron, I just took a cup and just kind of like started freaking gluing it to the actual cup. And it actually turned out pretty well. It was actually pretty neat. I looked like I had an ice cream head. Although every time I bent over, I always felt like it was going to fall over.
Another thing that you can do if you're looking for really weird shapes in the wig is whenever you're at Michael's or Hobby Lobby, you see that green foam that's meant for like putting flowers and
floral foam.
In.
Floral foam.
They have like rings and stuff. Like, let's say that I need two big rings on the side of this because for some reason anime hates me. If you sit there and get extra wig hair, you can just wrap it around that foam and make those really weird things. Like, if I want to do Chibi Moon and I need these two like football or dongo things out of my head, I can actually make just a pigtail wig out of the pink wig, get that foam, wrap it really tightly in that pink hair where it's done, and then put it onto the wig, and it's all an illusion. That's the thing. Like, also with pigtails, a lot of people think, oh, I have to sit here and wrap my wig into a pigtail. No, you actually really don't. What I would do with this wig, for example, since it's so thin and so short, and I need big pigtails, I would go get another wig that's the same color, and just cut two pigtails and then clip them on.
Yeah, it's amazing what you can do with attachments. We had a buddy who brought all of her wigs back to a point and then put one of those little screws from broom back there.
Oh,
the ponytail was just screwed in, so it looked like she was doing great
stubbing
herself.
No, it was really weird. Like, she was some kind of robot. Like, hold on, let me get the ponytail. Like, it was weird. So you just have to think outside the lines because wigs are kind of unforgiving in the sense that if they get ratted or whatever, you can tell it. So.
Yeah. And then always wear a wig cap if you can. It always sounds like such an easy thing to remember, but people put so much work into the costume, they kind of forget how to wear it.
Yeah, that's the thing. Wig caps, they're super cheap.
Yeah.
And you can get them from Sally's.
And it's also, it's a big issue, especially if you're going ahead and wearing a like teal wig or a very, very nice
gorgeous
wig. And you can see, oh look, we have a little bit of brown hair sticking out. It does not give you effect. And, you know, sometimes I think if you're competing, I think that can really throw the whole thing off.
And not even just when you're competing pictures, you'll come back and like, oh man, that picture would have been so cool.
If you're also worried about that wig cap showing, like for some reason there's part of the wig that needs to show or whatever, you can also take a tan wig cap and just dye it.
Oh yeah.
Which, in general, by the way, if you ever want to dye things at your local Walmart and Kroger's, in the detergent section, you have Rich Dye, R-I-T, and that stuff will dye anything that you need. It is so wonderful. If you put a little dash of salt in with it, they have both dry and liquid
Yeah, and they have the cold one, so you can do in the washer. Do not suggest that.
It works on wigs, too.
I've done it in the washer, and it did not wash the rest of my clothes. I'm really expecting it to. Like, I don't know. They say you can put it in the washing machine. I prefer a big bucket.
Yeah.
Yeah, big bucket to sit there making butter.
Actually, it's really neat, too. Like, I had feathers at one point, and I needed to have them. I had white feathers and pink dye, and I just sat there and did a gradient dye where you just dip the first part first, and then wait for that to dry, and then dip a little bit more, and you get that nude fade. So, and you can do that. Red dye kind of works on wigs.
It's a little slow, I would say.
It's a little bit slow, and it's very light, so just if you can stick a permanent marker.
It's really good if you're tinting a wig just a slightly different color. I'd say maybe like the Riku in the new King of Hearts. He went from having silver hair to having like
slightly purple hair.
Like, you'll never find that in a wig color. Red dye is good for that if you're just trying to subtly fade it. So.
And it gives you a good all-over cover.
Yeah.
They really messed up with Riku.
Why is he like short? We're not going to get into that.
Children.
Sorry, 3D has actually got me very, very upset.
We're a little bit nerdy, just at
that. Well, then that's, you know, King of Hearts is a great segue because you think all the stuff that's in it, the wings, some of the weird foam armor, the keyblades.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of different. Is anybody stuck on a costume? Is there something like, well, I was thinking about making this, but I just don't know how?
No questions.
We're
just too big
of
talkers.
We're
sorry.
Don't all jump out at once now.
Can you talk about armor attachment?
Armor attachment?
Oh, yeah.
That's
strap
it. Oh yeah, there's actually several different kinds. You can go ahead and do it the old-fashioned way, where you go ahead and build each piece and then hope it fits in.
Which rarely works.
Which does not work because our eyes, especially for some people that have depth perception problems, does not work properly. You can also use rivets. Rivets are amazing.
Rivets are my favorite, personally.
And they're very, very used a lot of times in the Halo armors. They use rivets to get them bendable joints.
I was about to say, at one point I was making Titus armor from Final Fantasy X, which, mind you, I love salvage in cosplay because I was going, how am I going to make that riveted part? I got plastic pots from Walmart, like potted plants, and cut them down the middle, and they have that lip on the edge, flipped it upside down, and just took like three halves of the pot, sprayed it, and then you take rivets, and you just make it to where it can bend, and you get this nice little caterpillar pots just to thread on there. And you can also, Velcro fishing line. I mean, you can glue it to part of the costume.
Yeah, I was going to say, for like the vacuum armor, since it's so light, I usually use a lot of Velcro when you get those weird costumes where it's like he's in a black spandex suit but randomly has a skull on him. So you can just kind of glue that, and all that is Velcro. And so it's just restickable and whatnot. As far as some of the other back and forth plastic stuff, duct tape honestly works because
oh my god, no. All of you, there's no duct tape anymore.
It's Gorilla Tape.
There's only Gorilla Tape.
Yes.
Go and play with Gorilla Tape.
When I wore this last time, I remember just Gorilla Taping myself into the costume and stayed the whole convention. And all it was just Gorilla Tape from here to here over my clothing and under my cape.
I've actually made an entire like bendable plushie that could like be posed out of just Gorilla Tape, some extra stuffing foam, and some wire. Like I formed the creature's body, stuffed it around, and just wrapped Gorilla Tape nonstop. And that stuff is amazing. It will not pull off. It's like 10 times stronger than duct tape.
Well, yeah, because it's meant for plumbing. It's meant to like catch a leak, so it can stand up to water.
And I believe that they do have Gorilla Tape now at Walmart.
Yeah.
And with that said, first of all, do not use that on your skin.
Should we tell the story?
Yeah, I think we should.
We're gonna tell you. So once upon a time, I had a friend who is gone now, bless her soul. No, she decided that she was going to do a male drow, which is a black-skinned elf, and she did a wrap, which we can talk about chest binding too. But she did a method of chest binding where you basically take tape and you pull back your boobs underneath it and you kind of tug them back so that you can have open shirts. Well, she decided that she was going to do this with tape. The problem with human skin is that, once again, whenever we get hot, we sweat. Whenever we sweat, we become moist. Whenever we become moist, our skin is soft. She wore this all day. She actually, I believe, won an award at the costume contest. Very happy. Came home to my house, says, I'm gonna go get out of my costume real quick. Goes in the bathroom, all we hear is this blood curdling scream. I go into the bathroom, and it looks like Wolverine has torn a chunk out of the side of her. So good God, be careful, that poor girl.
But she was Everclear, a long time.
She was like, get me alcohol. I'm like, I don't know what to do, drink. It was the worst thing. Like the next day, she couldn't even put a shirt on. It like claimed a small portion of her nipple.
Yeah, so just the skin just right off.
I know, everybody, the same face. But just please be careful with what you put on. And that's why I always suggest people to like put your costume on fully beforehand.
And walk around at home.
And you have to be realistic about it. Like that tape thing that I was talking about, that technique. Is only for photo shoots. It's called, I put that tape on for an hour. You do have to cover yourself with medical tape and gauze to make sure that doesn't happen. Make sure that you're not gonna hurt yourself.
Yeah, and do that even if for some reason that changes the appearance of the costume. I did something stupid at ACON a few years ago. There was this cosplay monster from-
Which one is this?
It's Yumel.
Okay. Yeah.
And it's got a monster foot that's like a raptor, and it's got a high heel. I'm like, I'm not gonna build like, you see now modernly most people, they're doing like the dragon heels or the choco heels, they'll just do the heel and they'll build it around it. I decided I was gonna stand on one tiptoe on one foot and a high heel on the other.
Can we make that a spare body part?
Yeah, it was a body part. part. But I mean, I was in that for like 8 hours. And
like
I
from Party City, they sell like the bloody like feet. We just like sliced the foot open and made it into a foot.
But yeah, I mean, that was bad planning on my part. And a lot of times you'll think, okay, this is going to be great. You try it on. Okay, that works great. Don't think that trying it on for 2 seconds means you're going to be able to walk into a convention and like, get bumped into. And people are like, oh my God, it's that guy. I'm going to hug him.
Well, and that's the other thing too. If you have like a costume with a wide berth, do not think. I remember it was at Acon 2002. I actually made this big giant pair of like yellow butterfly wings out of plywood. Don't ask me why I did that. That was a brilliant idea. I had to attach them with door hinges. whenever I walked through the hallways, I thought neon yellow wings made of plywood. Everybody will see it. Nope. Every 2 seconds, boom, boom. Oh, I didn't see you there. So really, and if it is a costume that's delicate, have two friends come with you and just trail you.
Yeah.
Be like, out of the way, get out of the way, cozy coming through. Like.
Yeah, when it comes to big costumes, I learned my lesson with that one. I've actually made Optimus Prime 2 years ago.
Oh,
and I had to save you.
It was a big issue because if you're gonna be in a big costume, make sure you also built in ventilation, or some type of holding for ice packs, because when you're in there, all that heat just kind of gathers and just sits there. Unless you have some way to go ahead and expel it out.
Oh, it becomes this delicious body soup.
Oh, it's amazing. It's like delicious. And this is actually the truth. So when I left, the cosplay lineup started at 2. Yeah. I left at 12:30. I got there at 2:30 because I could only one. I didn't try it on. That was rule number one, I failed.
Oh, man.
And so I could only walk about 1 inch a footstep.
It was the saddest little crippled Optimus.
Everything bent very, very well. It was so great. But the problem is I could not get any footing. And then the other thing is too, is that if you're going to be building those big costumes, be prepared to go ahead and be stopped every about 5 inches.
Yeah.
To her like a 30-minute photo session.
Oh yeah, the big costumes, you're just going to get the attention.
Yeah, you're just going to get the attention. The third thing is after I'm wearing it for only about 3 hours, I think I lost about 15 pounds.
That was water weight. So in the
Acon, they actually have the nice big blaring lights. The ones that you wonder why, how is it that performers always wear pants on the stage and they always like they're freaking sweating? Why do they do that? I have no idea why, but I realize that those lights are really, really hot.
Yeah, we're always curious if
their
spotlights are meant to keep food warm, and they're just like,
cheap. Exactly. You're like, oh, look, it's fast food. No, I'm not. I can only move 1 inch at a time. It's okay.
And you really, and that's the other thing, too. If you're going to be entering a cosplay, or you're going to be walking around, bring water, please, God.
Yeah.
Actually seen my, at Onicon 1, I actually saw a girl who was sitting there in costume, and I walked past her because I was on the way to cosplay, and she was doing this. And I go, what's wrong, sweetie? Are you okay? She goes, I'm... flat out, like it's like cartoon-ish. So please.
Yeah.
I've also seen, even if you're not, what was that?
Did you capture?
No, actually, I didn't. Aww. It was too far. It was like, no! I did stay there and I helped her afterwards. I didn't just walk off like, oh, it's
weird. You're not going to finish
the
sentence for
me,
whatever.
Fine.
Fine. Pass that in front of me, what's wrong with
you?
That's the other thing too. Even if you're not someone who's prone to seizures, I was actually originally on the medical staff, and I've seen people have seizures just from not sleeping, too much heat, etc.
You gotta take care of yourself. I think a lot of people make the mistake that they're full on hype. They're very excited to be here, and they just forget.
I do that thing too, where you're like, I'm not hungry anymore.
My body doesn't work.
Never want food again.
Exactly.
And you gotta make sure you can move. And the other thing that I thought about when we were talking about attaching armor, I made the mistake of like, you get these really cool big gauntlet boots that like Mega Man has and stuff like that. Make sure your ankles can move. I know that sounds really obvious, but I was walking around like an action figure on stage. I feel like it's a lot of
comfortable footwear is actually
a comfortable
thing.
Footwear.
If it is super uncomfortable armor too, just make it to where you can take it off quickly.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Actually, what I did for CerfBot and also for Optimus Prime, as soon as I got to the actual place we were holding, I immediately took off everything. Because a lot of people make the mistake of just like, oh, well, I'm in cosplay, I'm going to keep it on. When you go and do competitions, you're there for 3 hours before the actual event starts.
Yeah, and then you're there
and
for 2 hours.
And you can only pray that you're going to be within the first
competing
30
is
people.
Super fun and super worth it, but it is like, I'm committed to this.
So, you know, there's a reason why we die for cosplay.